Hello, this is Stephen Helfer, and you're watching the smoking section dedicated to people who smoke tobacco and dedicated to understanding that it's a much more complicated issue than simply tobacco is good for you, and if you stop smoking tobacco, you're going to be healthier than if you continue smoking tobacco. And I have known people who have quit smoking and made a great effort to quit smoking, thinking that it would somehow improve their health, and oftentimes it didn't, and they often lived a deprived life and wanted something that they thought they shouldn't have, dreamed about it, and didn't live healthier, didn't live happier, and didn't live healthier. Often they gain a lot of weight, which can really be hard on the heart, hard on the joints, not very good for one's self-esteem. They often find it more difficult to function during the day in terms of their concentration or their anxiety or their depression. They have to resort to more medications. This idea that if you stop smoking, you will be healthier is simplistic and is often wrong. Now, sometimes it may be the case that it is right. I don't know. But oftentimes I've seen people who don't improve. Now, one thing is that tobacco is what is called an expectorant. That means if you smoke, it will help clear out mucus, excess mucus, and that sort of thing from your lungs. And that's why some people, when they smoke, they do some coughing like that. But then if they stop smoking, rather than being an improvement in health, actually it just stops the body from naturally discharging. I think smoking is also very helpful for the digestive system. I think it cuts down on one's appetite, particularly for sweet food. This idea that if you quit smoking, you'll automatically be better, and that this smoking causes every disease known to mankind is really very poorly thought out. Now, for example, I have a friend who knows a man who's 87 years old who hasn't smoked for 40 years and who has developed some problems with COPD at the age of 87. And of course, he is told that, well, his smoking of 40 years ago is the cause. So it comes out, and I said to him, well, if you ever smoke in your life, then for the rest of your life, if you get any disease, never mind that these are diseases that plenty of people who don't smoke get, and often at very younger ages than 87, yet this man is convinced and persuading that smoking is the cause of his COPD. And it's kind of a magical kind of thinking, and it calls into the logical fallacy of post hoc ergo propter hoc. If something happens after, whatever happens after A is caused by A. So if you smoke and then you get a particular illness, it has to be caused by smoking. And this is a fallacy. And for example, I just saw an article in the Wall Street Journal where a PhD, I think is in biology, was talking about cancer and the causes of cancer and how when people get sick with cancer, which we all know is a horrible disease and we all, I think, live in some fear of, they always want to know, well, what caused my cancer? And it's very easy for a doctor to say, well, it was your smoking. are. It was because, I mean, I heard somebody on the radio the other day who had developed a cancer, and he said that he had spent 10 days in China, and the air pollution is very bad over there. Now, maybe the air pollution caused his 10 days exposure to air pollution. But of course, then he came down and said, well, when I was in high school, I played in some bands in some smoky bars, so maybe it was the secondhand smoke, which is kind of interesting because I just saw an article that was taken from, I think it was the National Journal of Meta-Analysis, where they did a tremendous analysis of many, many studies on secondhand smoke, a very scientific study, and they found that none of the epidemiological studies that have been done on secondhand smoke, that all of them put together, comes out that there is no evidence, no good evidence, no strong evidence that anyone gets lung cancer from secondhand smoke. And even from firsthand smoke, according to most of the scientific evidence, 80 to 90% of lifelong heavy smokers, that 80 to 90% of them don't get lung cancer. So if smoking causes it, why should 80 to 90% of lifelong heavy smokers not get lung cancer? And one reason that many more non-smokers don't get lung cancer is because when doctors examine people looking for cancer of the lung, if the person is a smoker, they will look hard for it. If the person is a non-smoker, they'll tend not to look as much. So that, for example, if the disease has metastasized and it's in the lung, they often will assume it's the primal cause is if the person's a smoker and the person's a non-smoker will occur in someplace else. So all of these things are very, very difficult to sort out, and the condemnation of smoking, the universal condemnation of smoking, and the harassment of people who smoke are something that I think is very bad in our society. I think it's very bad to harass anybody in the society, unless, of course, they are engaged in illegal activity. But this kind of what I heard referred to as vengeance politics that's going on, and there's a lot of it going on. There's a lot of, I would say, really rancorous. I read in the Globe today, this I can't remember the woman's name, but I mean the language she uses to describe people who she disagrees with is so strident and so filled with invective. And I think that probably if she was a smoker, she might be a little bit milder, a little bit more forgiving of her enemies. And of course, as I've mentioned on the program, that is the reason that American Indians so revered tobacco. They found it so useful as a way to bury the hatchet or help bury the hatchet. And that's why they always used it. American Indians always used tobacco whenever they had a peace council or a council of any sort. And they also felt, and this has been supported by modern medicine, that it helped them to understand complex matters better. And we have very strong evidence from a scientific medical approach that smoking does, and nicotine does, tobacco does, enhance cognition. In fact, according to some researchers in the field of cognition, nicotine is the most powerful and reliable cognitive enhancer that they know of. And that's another reason that it is being experimented with for Alzheimer's and Parkinson's disease and even mild cognitive impairment. Well, I wanted to give a shout out to Maria, who works at Cambridge City Hospital, is always a very pleasant person who works the cash register there. And she has, on several occasions, mentioned that she is an occasional viewer of the smoking section. And very nice to see Maria there whenever I go there to have their delicious and very inexpensive meals. Now, I think I'm going to go straight to the smoker of the week if I can find him. Always a little bit of a feat to find our smoker of the week, but I think I just pulled him up and we'll go right to it. And here we have Pine Top Perkins at the age of about, I think he was 95 in this. And he started smoking when he was about 11 or 12. And he continued smoking right up until his death, probably caused by cigarettes, but it was at the age of 97. So it took 85 years of smoking to kill him. And he was still performing as a musician into his 90s, played with some of the greats like Muddy Waters. And there in the town where he lives, or where he lived, which is in Mississippi, they have every year they have a Pine Top Perkins Day. And this is Pine Top Perkins. A couple of years ago in Mississippi, enjoying a cigarette right up until the time of his death, which again was at the age of 97. So if tobacco is lethal, as we are told, why is it that someone like Pine Top Perkins lived to be 97? Well, we're told that's just an anecdote. And again, as we have said on this program, anecdotes only count when they are used against smoking, never when they are used for smoking. Then they don't count. But when, if otherwise, they count very much. Well, we had an article in the Globe recently, and was featured on our Facebook page, which is Cambridge Citizens for Smokers' Rights on Facebook. And it was Science, the title of the article was an Associated Press article, was Science Looks at Marijuana and Tobacco, and trying to sort out, well, marijuana has medical benefits, but of course the article fails to mention all the medical benefits that tobacco has. And this was not surprising, but I think there is a reason that so many people, even though they face harassment and punitive taxes, continue smoking. And I don't think it's just simply because they're addicted and they can't stop. I know people who, you know, stop smoking and they don't feel all these wonderful benefits. But so this article, one of the big differences, of course, between marijuana smoking and tobacco smoking that I do have to acknowledge is that marijuana smoking, you don't smoke as many. It's pretty rare that someone will smoke 20 marijuana cigarettes a day, whereas tobacco cigarettes, that is pretty common. But one thing that is, I think, that does have to be taken into consideration is that unlike marijuana, tobacco does not intoxicate people. So there is no danger in driving a car while smoking, no danger operating dangerous machinery, or if your high school student is smoking tobacco or is vaping, there's no danger that he will find it difficult to do his homework or find it difficult to pass tests. Whereas marijuana, on the other hand, impairs your judgment. You can make decisions and do things and get in bad situations from marijuana that you can't from tobacco. And of course, our mental clarity is something that is very, very important, and perhaps more important than our physical health, that we are able to make decisions clearly. And that's why, for example, no teenager has ever crashed his car or fallen off a roof or fell into Boston Harbor, etc. Or there was just recently a case out in someplace, I think in JP, where a 19-year-old fellow left a party and the next day he was found dead, and I think he had fallen someplace, not off a roof, but that is something that never happens with tobacco. And that's a good point to be aware of. Now, I was just at Levitt and Pierce the other day, and Levitt and Pierce is very, they like to not put the state taxes, the state excise tax and the state sales tax, they don't include it in their prices of cigars. And that's kind of interesting because they do include it in their cigarettes, but they were always saying, well, you buy this cigar for $4 and then there's a 40% tax on that, which is the state excise tax and the sales tax combined. And I explained to them that they are forgetting one important tax that they don't include on that, and that is the federal excise tax. So they are telling their customers, they are actually not explaining to their customers just how much tax they are paying for cigars. So while everyone likes to put down smokers and complain about smokers, very few people in states like Massachusetts, and Massachusetts has had, I think, the second highest cigarette taxes in the country after New York State. They're very happy to take our money and to use it to build the roads and maintain the subways and help bail out the universal medical care and stuff like that that we have here. But we don't get any credit for it. And they even have the nerve to say that we end up costing this system money, whereas in fact, smokers are actually subsidizing non-smokers in many, many ways, but primarily and importantly through tobacco taxes that we have paid since the time of the Revolutionary War. So that's billions upon billions upon billions of dollars that the state and federal governments have taken from smokers, and going way, way, way back, way before there were automobiles, way before there was a gas tax, way before there was an income tax, and so forth. So that's another thing. Now, a lot of people are very unhappy about the current federal government under Donald Trump. And whereas Cambridge Citizens for Smokers' Rights is completely nonpartisan, we take no position on any kind of policy unrelated to tobacco. We do have to note that under the previous administration, under the Obama administration, to me, the most unfair and draconian anti-smoking measures came about. I'm going to list them. One was a increase in the federal excise tax on cigarettes from, I think, 39 cents to $1.01 a pack. So that means every single pack of cigarettes sold in the United States, the federal government is taking $1.01, which is actually an increase, quite an increase, if you think about it, and adds a great deal to the federal coffers. And then, under the Obama administration, roll your own tobacco. The tax on roll your own tobacco was increased from 80 cents a pound to $24.78 a pound. I'm a little bit wrong on those numbers if Michael McFadden is watching, but they're close, which was probably the largest tax hike perhaps in the history of the country in terms of an existing tax being increased. Also under the Obama administration, the Department of Health and Human Services pressured colleges and universities to ban smoking on the grounds of their colleges and universities. Now, for example, I worked for 22 years at Harvard University. If I had had to leave the grounds of the university to smoke, which I did smoke during those 22 years, that would have seriously interfered with my the ability to perform my job and put me at risk of being fired. So while some people think this is just a simple little regulation, this makes it very, very difficult for anybody who is a smoker to be either a student, an employee, or a professor at any college or university which has passed this. And I assume that many of them have. I know that most of the schools at Harvard did, I think Northeastern, Wentworth, I don't know about BU and BC. Oh, I know American University did because I was down there, and of course I deliberately smoked on campus, but and was not seen or caught. Also, the during the Obama administration, the FDA took control of tobacco in 2009. And recently, of course, we were worried about the FDA reducing the nicotine level in cigarettes to almost nothing, which would, of course, be similar to taking all the alcohol out of wine or all the alcohol out of whiskey. It would make them very undesirable. And also remove any of the health benefits. And also the FDA was considering banning menthol cigarettes. And of course, these are things that now look like they, God willing, will not happen. Also, the S-CHIP, which is a kind of insurance program for supposedly for children who come from poor families, is funded entirely by another tax, I think, put on smoking and on tobacco, and so only smokers pay for this. Thus far, we haven't seen too much in the last few years in terms of federal legislation. Thanks for watching the Smoking Section. See you next week.